So first thing I want to do is ask you what answers we got for this one. Alex?
I got one.
Got one. Okay, so I'm going to go like this. One. Something besides one. Sean?
Nine.
And nine. Yes?
I got three. Seven.
Seven. Okay. Anything besides those? Okay. Let's just come to this next one. And what's an answer we got for this one? Alex?
Six.
Got six for that. Something other than six. Cadence? No? Monica?
0.6
repeating, which is 2/3. Cadence?
Yeah, I got 2/3.
You got 2/3 as well? Okay.
I have a question on that. Can you just leave it 2/3 or can you just, do you have to do 0.6?
I really prefer fractions.
Okay.
That's not wrong. 0.6 is wrong. 0.6 repeating is not wrong. Okay. The reason I prefer fractions is because for someone who has done this, you can almost guarantee 100% if you use your calculator, right? Which is not a bad thing to use your calculator, but when it's something that is fairly straightforward, it kind of makes me wonder, does this person depend on their calculator a little more than necessary? Okay. So I'm not gonna mark you wrong if you put 0.6 repeating, that is the curve, it's equivalent to the fraction 2/3. But I would prefer that we use fractions for no other reason than we're not afraid of fractions. Right? They're not a big deal. Find common denominators to add and subtract, multiply straight across. When we divide, how do we divide
reciprocal
fractions? Reciprocal of which?
You switch the top and bottom, or the numerator and denominator on the second fraction.
The second fraction? Which one's the second fraction?
The one after the first one.
How about the fraction that we're dividing by?
Yeah.
Okay? We're dividing the one that's in the divisor, right? Or in the denominator, or the one that we're dividing by, that's the one we take the reciprocal of and multiply by that reciprocal. So, fractions, not a big deal, not a scary thing. This last one. Great.
Got two.
Got two. Something else?
I got something really far from two.
Far, far,
got
far
288.
Away. 288.
Yeah.
Right? Every one of these has at least two answers. Okay. So which one's right? John?
On the first one, I think it's nine.
Is that the one you got?
Yeah.
Well, then naturally, you would think it was nine, right?
I think it's nine because if you follow the order of operations, that's the answer you get.
Okay. Here's an interesting word. The.
Yeah.
Okay. Why do I say that that's an interesting word? How did you just use that word, Josie?
I call it the order of operations.
The order of operations. Okay. All right. So you brought that up, so let me just do this. I'm gonna have you work through this again. You may get a different answer this time, you may get the same answer that you just got. Okay, but I'm just gonna add a little something to this, to each of these. Okay, that one gets that, this one gets this, this one gets this. we get for this first one now? What answers are we getting now? Sean?
I still got 9.
You got 9. Second time around, got 9. Anything else? Seems to be kids?
No.
No? Seems to be a lot more agreement this time. Okay, how about the second one? Johnny?
2/3.
Got 2/3. The second time around, Johnny's got 2/3. Anything else? Any other answers? No? Seems like we kind of fixed the disagreement here. What about this last one? Looking for somebody who hasn't answered yet. Blake? You got 288. You didn't get 2, okay? Anybody get anything else? Anything different? You all get 288? Okay. Are these the right answers then? Because we all got the same ones?
No. Never mind.
Yes.
Interesting theory.
It should be, but
start from there. Kind of puts a lot of pressure on everybody. Well, what the right answer here is kind of tricky because what does right mean?
The correct answer.
Correct. According to what?
Our opinion.
There is kind of an opinion here.
Laws of math.
What opinions might be different? What opinions would give me different answers? Josie touched on it earlier. Or Jacob.
People not following the order of operations.
There's that word again. The order of operations. Where does the order of operations come from? Don't say that enough. Sean, where does it come from? Who gave it to us? From where was it handed down?
I don't know. But I was going to say I lived in like 6th grade.
Okay. From who?
Well, 2 years ago, actually.
2 years ago?
Yeah, from Mr. Zelay.
Mr. Zelay. Okay, so Mr. Zelay taught you this order, right? Okay. Where else does it come from? Where did Mr. Zelay get it?
I don't know.
Probably his math teacher. Jacob, theories?
No.
No, Josie?
Like, when you keep, if you, like, so this is like a, this math teacher, that math teacher got from the math teacher before, and it keeps going all the way back to like the first math people, and then they figured out the way that we should do things to get the
Thanks.
Correct answer.
Okay, interesting. Because this goes back to the beginning of math. And the first math teacher taught the first math student, and all the way down to Mr. Zelay. Kids?
So pretty much they decided how to do it.
Right, there was a decision, right? Can you decide something that's true? You know what I'm saying? Can I decide that, you know, gravity works? Decide that the Earth pulls me toward it, can I decide that?
Yeah.
No.
To decide that I can, to say that I can decide it, is to imply that I can decide that it doesn't do that. And I decide that it doesn't do that, it's not a decision that I make, it just happens, right? These things right here, they don't just happen, you decided about them, right? Sean?
Well, I was thinking maybe, well, the answer could also be other things than just 9. For the first one, it could be 3 times 3. That would also be an answer because.
Okay. Those two answers, 3 times 3 and 9, would be equivalent to each
yeah.
other, right? So that's something we also can't decide. 3 times 3 is 9. There's no debate about it, right?
Yeah.
But without these parentheses, 6 divided by 2 times (1+2), can be debated. We could decide which way we answer depending on which order we follow. Why do we follow which order we follow? Because somebody along the line decided that we would. I found a cool article on slate.com where they talk about problems like this that have become they're memes, and they come up every so so often, every few months or a year or something, someone will post a problem like this, and people will get different answers, people will argue back and forth, yell at each other, and curse, and say, I'm right, this is the way that I learned it, this is you're so dumb, you don't know how to do the order of operations. But the order that we follow was decided by somebody or some group of people. It turns out, according to the article that I read, it probably goes back to like the beginning of the 20th century, so like the early 1900s, when textbooks were becoming standardized. And we kind of decided that we would follow this order right here. Okay. If I didn't have a decided order, if nobody agreed on what the order was, how could I make it so that there was no way to get two different answers here? How did I do it today?
You changed the problem statement.
Changed it how?
By adding
parentheses. Put parentheses in there. Now, by putting parentheses there, the order that I want you to follow is what?
Changed. Obvious.
Obvious. It's obvious. The order that I want you to do these in is obvious. Before that, it was not obvious. It was ambiguous. It was vague. I didn't know, couldn't tell exactly which order I wanted to do it in. So today what I want to do is I want to show you the order that we're going to use, okay? The order that I've used all my life, the order that I have seen most people use that I've come into contact with in math classes and things like that in university and high school. The order that you would follow to get the correct answer on most like tests like the ACT, the SAT, the GRE, a bunch of different standardized tests, okay? Doesn't mean it's right. Doesn't mean it's the right answer or it's the order of operations. It's just the order of operations we're gonna use. And then it turns out a lot of people use, okay? Used to be when you read a book or you read a paper about math, at the beginning, you would have to read what the author decided, what order the author decided to use, right? And one big dispute is, when I see parentheses, or, well, I don't want to accuse you about which one I'm talking about. If I'm looking at this, and now I'm trying to decide which order to do it in, and I see that parentheses right there on the right, and there's two right next to it, some people think, well, that's implied that I would do that first, because two is right next to the parentheses. They call it implied by juxtaposition, or right next to each other, so I multiply them first, okay? We're not going to do that. The way we're going to do it, and I know this is the way Mr. Zalay has it in his room, and I like it. And not just written like a word from left to right, which can confuse people, because when you write it like this, people think, a lot of people, do this always first, always, always, before division, and then do division. Okay? Is that wrong?
Yes.
Okay.
It's not wrong.
Not really.
It's just another way to do it. Okay? If I decide that multiplication is always going to come first before division, multiplication, all of them, all the multiplications you see, and then do all the divisions, then when I write an expression like this, I'll have that in mind. I'll know that you're going to think the same thing, and then I can make sure that you are going to do it in the order that I was thinking you would do it. Okay? It's about the person who writes it and the person who reads it thinking the same thing. Okay? So that's what we have to decide. How are we going to think about it? Here's what we're going to think. First parentheses, it's almost a silly thing to even include in the order of operations because why wouldn't you do parentheses first? They're a natural thing that draws your attention to the things inside the parentheses. Right? When I put parentheses around 6 divided by 2, you naturally did what was inside the parentheses. Okay? Then, what is this?
Exponents.
Exponents. Okay, so if you see exponents, always do the exponents first. Johnny?
So, if you had an exponent in parentheses, would you do the parentheses first, though?
I'm not quite sure, so let's give an example. Like, tell me what you're talking about.
Like, for example, like 3 to the power of 2 plus 2.
Like that?
Yeah.
But all this is in parentheses?
Yeah. And then there's, like, other stuff.
Okay, so if we were to, so far we don't need anything other than parentheses and exponents, okay? And some other stuff. Okay, we'll put other stuff in there. So do the parentheses and the exponents first. Okay, so parentheses is what I would do first. It's first on the list, right?
Mm-hmm.
But when I look inside the parentheses, I have a little mini problem here, right? And then I need to evaluate, like, what do I do first inside of the parentheses, and I kind of start all over again in that order, right? There's parentheses inside of parentheses, then I'll do those parentheses first, right? If I look inside the parentheses and there's an exponent, I'll do the exponent first, right?
Okay.
So do the exponent first, because there's no way to evaluate the parentheses until I know what this number is, so that I can add 2 to whatever that number is. So that would be inside.
And the exponent's inside parentheses, you do the exponent first.
Of course, because when we say, okay, do the parentheses first, and we look inside the parentheses, we then have to ask ourselves, what inside the parentheses do I do first? How do I get these parentheses away, right? Done, evaluated. So I would do the exponent first. I think this is pretty clear. I mean, there's not really any other way to do it because 3 squared, I wouldn't try and do anything else. Like, I wouldn't probably try to add 2 to the 3. But maybe if it was 2 plus 3 squared, if I didn't have an order of operations agreed upon, there's no reason why I wouldn't add the 2 and the 3, and then square that number, right? You see what I mean? Why shouldn't I? The reason we shouldn't here now in this class as we move forward after today is because there's an order that we all agreed that we would follow, right? So, we would square this first, get 9, add 2, get 11. So exponents next, multiplication and division, next, in this class, you and I, we will follow multiplication and division at the same time. Like, multiplication does not come before division unless it's on the left, because we go from left to right. Okay? So, when I write something like this, what I would expect you to do, because we're going to follow this order that we agreed on, all right? I would expect that you kind of, with your imagination, put parentheses around there already, because that's what you're going to do first, because it's a division, right? It's on the left. We do multiplication and division from left to right. There's a parentheses, of course, we'll add 1 and 2 and get 3. Okay. 6 divided by 2 times 3. Okay. But now it comes down to, do we divide this first or multiply this first? That's all there is, division and multiplication left. So we work it from left to right. Parentheses is on top, it's first, exponents is next, it comes before anything else, and the multiplication and division, they're on the same level. We work from left to right. So we would do this first, 6 divided by 2 is 3, multiply that by 3, and we get 9. Okay, multiplication and division from left to right. And then after we're done with all the multiplications and divisions, we'll do addition and subtraction. That's the order from left to right, addition and subtraction, left to right. That's the order that we will agree to. It's the order that a lot of people use, but it's not the order of operations, as if some kind of truth that's as true as gravity, okay? Or 2 plus 2 is 4, right? We just agree on it. The only way we could not disagree is if I put parentheses around every pair of numbers and left no vagueness, no ambiguity. I was very obvious about what I wanted you to do first. Okay. Why do we have this order anyway? Why don't I just put parentheses around every pair of numbers so that nobody ever gets confused? If I can just put parentheses around every pair of numbers and get the order to be obvious, why don't I just do that?
Yeah. Because it's not necessary.
Why isn't it necessary?
Because you'll still get the same answer if you just do it regularly.
What's regularly?
Like, without the parentheses.
So we're imagining we don't have an order that we're going to follow.
Yeah, we do. But, like, without parentheses on 6 divided by 2, and then parentheses 1 plus 2, you'd still get this. I still got the same answer without the parentheses as with, so.
Yeah. I'll just, instead of being vague and asking questions, if I didn't have an order of operations and I wanted you to know which order to do things, like imagine there's no PEMDAS, it's just stricken from human memory, it doesn't exist anymore, and I wanted you to do things in a certain order, I would have to communicate that somehow. That would have to be with parentheses, there's no other way to do it. Otherwise, everybody's just kind of up in the air about which thing to do first. Okay. The reason why we want to have this order of operations instead of doing parentheses is that's a lot of parentheses. There are lots of expressions out there, and to put parentheses around every pair of numbers in every expression everywhere in the world would be a lot of extra ink and a lot of extra time. And, well, we want to save ink and we want to save time. We save paper, obviously. So we agree to this order so that we can kind of standardize it. So everybody does the same thing, the same order, the same way. Right? And that's what we're going to do. So let's practice that with a couple of expressions. Okay? So we're at this. We don't have parentheses around all the pairs of numbers. You can imagine if there was absolutely no order and you could just do it in any order you wanted, there'd be a lot of different ways to get answers. But do it in the order that we just discussed. Parentheses first, next one is next, multiplication, division together from left to right, and addition and subtraction last. Right. You guys ever heard the phrase, slow is smooth, smooth is fast? Have you ever heard that before? That was true. Slow is smooth, and smooth is fast. If you're trying to do this problem, you might want to do it as fast as possible, doing as many steps in your head as you can. And if you really practice, then that's not that bad an idea. But if you find that you get answers that are a little off of what other people are getting, slow it down, make it smooth, make sure it's right, and it'll be faster in the long run. Okay. Because you're going to have to redo all your work. So, parentheses, no parentheses. Exponents, no exponents. So we're just down to multiplication, division, addition, and subtraction. So we have multiplication here. So without having to write them, I can kind of mentally put parentheses around those. Okay, minus whatever this number is. Right, so we'll do those. Actually, we could, whether I do this first and don't add the one and the two, or I go ahead and add the one and the two, it won't make a difference. Right, so I can just do that right now. So 3. That's from 1 plus 2 plus 3 plus whatever 4 times 5 is, that's 20, minus whatever 18 minus 3 is, which is 6, so 18 divided by 3 is 6. Okay. Now we have no more multiplication or division, so we'll do this first, and then we'll add this on, and then we'll subtract that. We get 6 plus 20 minus 6, that's 26 minus 6. If you know the order that we all agree to do it in, and you do it slow, and make sure that every step is done correctly, there should be no room for error, nobody should get any different answers. 3 plus 3. Slow is smooth, smooth is fast. Let's do another one. Okay, so what comes first here? Alex?
The exponent.
Exponent. No parentheses, exponents are next. We can do exponent. And only that if we wanted to. We can also look and say, exponents first does not mean that other things can't happen at the same time. It just means if anything's trying to interact with this 4 in any way, don't do anything with that 4 until you square it. Right? Let's say this 15 divided by 5. That doesn't have anything to do with the 4. It's not trying to interact, it's not trying to do anything before the exponent, right? 15 divided by 5, I can see into the future a little bit, that's going to come next, isn't it? So I'll just go ahead and do that too. And I don't have to write a lot of steps. 15 divided by 5 is 3. Okay, so that's going to happen. There we go. All right, so exponent's done, no parentheses. And we do multiplication and division next. So there's a multiplication, there's a multiplication. You start to kind of see things that are multiplied as little groups, little clusters that are stuck together, right? So we'll do 3 times 16 and 3 times 3, because if I didn't do 3 times 3 right now, I'd just do it in the next step. What's 3 times 16?
48.
Plus 3 times 3, I could do that. That's 9, 7. 48 plus 9 is 57. Minus 7 is 50. Kind of a busy example, lots of things to do, but if we do it slow and smooth, and we'll get the right answer, well, the answer that I wanted you to get by the way I wrote this down, right? We should all get the same answer as each other. Alex?
Well, I got the same answer, but I did it a little differently. I took 9 minus 7 and got 2, and then I put 48 plus 2.
9 minus 7 is 2, 48 plus 2 is 50.
Yeah.
Yeah. See, then we get into these properties of numbers, and you're using the property called associativity. Remember the associative property?
Yeah.
Unitive property and all those kinds of things? That means when we're adding a bunch of numbers together, it doesn't matter which order we add them. So what Alex did was to add 9 plus negative 7 before he added the 48. It's not going to make a difference. I'm just adding a bunch of numbers up. Okay? If I add these together over here, and then these, and then add this third one in there, and whatever order I add the numbers together, it doesn't matter. Subtraction's different. I can't do 9 minus 7 is the same as 7 minus 9, or that even work. So you see it as addition. 9, 7. Yeah, that's basically what it comes down to. You can't do 9 minus 7 is the same as 7 minus 9. Okay. So yeah, we can do it in that different order. As long as we view subtraction as really negative numbers that are being added to other numbers. That's the last thing I wanted to do before we do this. This is going to be tomorrow, okay? We'll test on finding the areas, fractions, order of operations. Right? Anybody feel like you're not ready to do that yet? Something that needs to be clarified or questions need to be asked. Okay. Then what I'm going to do here in the last few minutes, I'm just going to hand out a review. It looks a lot like what the test is going to look like. Okay. Don't worry. This is not a test I'm handing you. It's just some review practice problems. All right. There you are.
Question, are we turning these in or are we just for our practice?
They are just for you, so I don't require that you do it and turn it in. I do require that you make this time productive, so a pretty good way to do that is to work on this. And if you can be productive in another way, study a different way, then that would be fine as well.
On test, are we going to have a calculator as well?
Yeah, you can have a calculator, but not your phone, right? You got to have a regular kind of a calculator, and I have some you can borrow. Right. Also, the formulas for the areas are not going to be on the test. You're going to have to remember them. Am I asking you to memorize them?
No.
Then we spend a bunch of time on areas of things. Yeah, we can
understand
them. If you remember them, great. If you kind of are fuzzy on them, you should be able, because you understand what the area is, the number of squares that fit, you should be able to rearrange those shapes, okay, in a way that creates a rectangle. Okay.